because I work at Target and I'm broke. So I bought a $5 phone case and painted it.
No way.
That's smart.
That's good.
That's awesome.
Yeah. It is 1:31, so I guess we should get started. I know there are a couple of other people that said they would be coming, but they're not here yet, and they're late, so that sucks for them. Sorry. Okay, so as I'm sure most of you know, this is our Bioware Deconstruction panel. So basically, we're going to be taking the two like most popular Bioware games and kind of like talking about what makes them tick, what makes them so interesting, what makes them immersive, and what makes them such lovable games. We might also discuss a couple of little flaws, like excessively shiny hair in Dragon Age, but... Oh my god. Too shiny. But first, for anybody that hasn't seen it yet, I went ahead and threw in this. This is the trailer from N7 Days.
A new home. But when we finally awoke, our dreams of peace were shattered. Welcome back.
You're the new Pathfinder.
This is incredible.
It's acting like a gravity well.
I have a bad feeling.
We're the aliens.
Introduction to BioWare as a company. They're based in Edmonton, Alberta, and what a lot of people don't know is that they also have an office in Austin, Texas, which mm-hmm. is really interesting to me. I never knew that. But it was actually founded by 3 med school graduates. So if you ever think that it's too late in your life to change your course and what you want to do, think of BioWare. So they're owned by EA, which has honestly been both a good and a bad thing for them if you think about, you know, the publishing. Dragon Age 2, I think, is the biggest example of why it was a bad thing for them. They produced several really popular games. Neverwinter Nights, I think, was one of their first really big one. Neverwinter and Baldur's Gate. But in this panel, we're specifically talking about Dragon Age and Mass Effect, which is probably, like, their 2 biggest franchises. Okay, so first we're gonna just kind of like touch on Mass Effect for people in the audience that may not know. This is kind of like the basic introduction. Mm-hmm. Their first game was released in 07, followed by ME2 in 2010 and ME3 in 2012. You'll notice with those games, they've got a couple of years in between each for development. With the Dragon Age series, they had exactly 1 year after the release of Origins to develop Dragon Age 2, and that's why it's such a controversial game, because everybody thinks it sucks. But yeah, it's very critically acclaimed for immersive and engaging story and characters, which we will be discussing, and y'all just saw the Andromeda cinematic trailer there. Yeah, Origins almost didn't happen. Basically, like, the lead writers and developers in the project were given several kind of like ultimatums by EA, like, have these certain things in the game and have these certain things done, or you're not getting your game. Because at the time, it was... EA saw it as very much like... They didn't know if it was going to be successful. They didn't think it would be successful, but they kind of went with it anyways to see where it would go. And then it ended up being one of the more popular game series, you know, known in the world. So it kind of worked out good for them. Like I said, began with Origins in 09. Dragon Age 2 was released in 2010, 1 year later, which, if anybody knows anything about the game industry, is not enough time to create a fully immersive game, which is why you've got, like, all the dungeons in DA2 look exactly the same. Yeah, it's like they all have the exact same floor layout. It's like, and then you don't really have like full character customization, which actually worked out in their favor almost, because Hawk is now one of the most beloved characters in the series. Hawk is great. But yeah, you've got all these things and everybody, so it's like, there was a lot of like flack for that game, but it's honestly because BioWare only had a year to develop it. And then Inquisition was kind of like their introduction to the semi-open world mechanics. And that last little line, I think, is actually wrong. So, because the first exclusively homosexual characters were in Mass Effect 3 with Steve Cortez and Samantha Trainor. But yeah, part of what makes these games so successful is that your choices impact almost every part of gameplay, except in Mass Effect 3. We're still mad about that. I couldn't save Legion.
Yeah.
I cried like a baby. I couldn't play the game for a few days after that because I could not save Legion. Okay? Because it makes you think you have a choice. And you don't. You can't save Legion.
He has a soul.
He does have a soul. This unit does have a soul. By the way, this panel is going to have a lot of spoilers for people that have not yet played the games. I apologize, I should have said that first. Yeah, I couldn't save Legion.
You can't save Legion.
I can't save Legion. These, every, like, the player choices impact almost every part of gameplay. That carries over from previous games, too. Because I didn't realize that in Mass Effect 2...
The Solarian.
I'm sorry, what?
What's the Solarian's name?
More than
just about. I was literally just about to say the name. In ME2, if you don't destroy the Genophage cure, no matter what you do in ME3, Morgan will die. Mm-hmm. You have to destroy the data on the... And I didn't know that. It's like you have to meticulously...
You have to destroy the data, and you have to kill Rex in the first game.
Yes. And you have to kill Rex, which I can't do.
You gotta convince him that not go back to war. So if Rex dies, cure the Genophage and save Morden, but Rex has to be dead.
Exactly.
Yeah.
You have to sacrifice.
I was so upset because one of my friends was just like, oh yeah, as long as you're like trying to cure the Genophage, then Morden won't die. And I'm like, okay, I've fully supported the Genophage cure throughout all of the games. And then Morden dies, and I was like, because I was fully expecting in that scene, I was like, okay, the tower's collapsing, he's still going to survive because I was told he would. I was wrong. I was very wrong, and Morden was like one of my favorite characters, I think.
Yeah, I love it so.
Oh, something that might come up in this, I'm just going to say it there. She has this habit of saying, oh, I don't know if I like this character that much. And then like a week later, oh my god, I love him.
Yes.
I hated Sarah and Vivian. I hated them so much. And then I started interacting with them more, and I'm like, I would kill a man for Vivian. and Sarah is like my child. But yeah, choices carry over from previous games as well. So it's like, playing ME3, I think, without playing the first two games is going to be very difficult because you're going to watch all of these characters die. Mm-hmm. Because you have to have done their loyalty missions in Mass Effect 2 for them to survive. So it's like, please play the other games before you play Mass Effect 3. Because you're going to watch all these people just die around you, and you're just going to be like, why? A big part of what draws a lot of people to the series is the romantic subplots, because I don't know, I feel like everybody just kind of has that.
It's a dating sim with a plot.
A dating sim in space.
The diversity, inclusivity of multiple sexuality, stuff like that. Okay, so one of the first big themes that we're really going to kind of deconstruct here and actually talk about is that major themes, particularly in Dragon Age, not so much in Mass Effect, is religion. So there's a lot of major themes and implications, like how much control the Chantry has over, like, everything. Okay, the Chantry controls, like, everything, and it's like, they try to tell you, they even say a couple of times in-game, it's like, oh, we have separation of church and state. That is not at all true, because you've always got a Chantry sister whispering in the Viscount's ear. Or, you know, just basically, like, rulers thinking along the lines of, if I do this, it's going to piss off the Chantry. So... as much as they like to try to convince you that they have separation of church and state, they do not. And that kind of reminds me of certain things in real life, yeah. Just marriage defies the sanctity of marriage. It's like, in your religion, maybe?
Yeah, right.
We don't all live under your religion. Why should it be law? Chantry. A lot of them actually reflect the real world religions. So you've got the Chantry with Catholicism. I'm talking way too fast because I have a little bit less time for this panel than I thought I would. I thought I would have an hour and a half, and I have an hour. So I'm talking really fast, but they have like Catholicism, especially with Andraste kind of being almost the equivalent of Jesus, and like instead of the son of God, she's the wife of their God, she's the wife of the Maker. And then you've got the Black Chantry Interventor that reflects Judaism, where they believe, you know, she wasn't the wife of the Maker, she was his prophet. It's kind of like a similar base there. So you've got, you know, and it ends up being kind of like a bit of a conflict there. Dalish really reflects the polytheism, especially they have a lot of like Celtic aspects to their culture. The Qunari is really similar to Confucianism in that it's not necessarily a religion, but a code of ethics that they live by. And then Dwarven ancestor worship kind of relates to a couple of different cultures, specifically, I think, like ancient Chinese. They're very much, you know, into the ancestor worship and stuff. They revere their ancestors as the people that came before them and kind of like paved the way for the world that they have now. So again, we were talking about the influence in the politics as well as socioeconomic status. The way the Chantry kind of oppresses the mages and also elves, like in Inquisition. In Inquisition, just like the Maker would send no elf in our darkest hour. It's like, shut the hell up, woman, I'm saving your life. I'm sorry, this is supposed to be a family-friendly panel and I'm saying bad words. but yeah, they have a heavy influence in politics as well as the socioeconomic status. It's not only like how the Chantry oppresses like peoples as well as other cultures. It's like they see the Dalish as savages, the Qunari, especially in Kirkwall in DA2, there's a lot of conflict because they just, not only do they see their physical appearance as being other from them, but it's also, you know, you've got the, what are they called? The people that aren't like, it's the people that aren't
the people from the Qunari
race, but they're like
yeah, but they converted to the Qun, yeah. The Vidasari. Okay. Yeah. I was like, what are they called?
That was killing everybody.
Vidasari. Yeah, so it's like the Vidasari, even the Vidasari are kind of like, they use them as spies, but if you find out they're, if people find out they're the Vidasari, they're kind of like, I don't trust you as much anymore because now I know you're a spy. But yeah. So religion has a really huge part to play in a lot of it. So then we've got race. Look at the naked Tyrion. this one's going to be really in-depth, especially. You've got like a bunch of different races in... Yeah, you've got a bunch of different races in both the games that are kind of what makes the game immersive. One of the things that I think I included later, but didn't include on this particular slide, is that you also have variations within the races as well. So like, you don't just have humans, you have humans of like a million different skin colors and backgrounds and cultures depending on where they came from. But it's part of what makes the game so immersive because real life is not just like one type of person everywhere, you know? It's like, the real world is not a bunch of white men.
Right.
So they each carry a very wide range of distinctive races and cultures, like how the Tyrians are very militaristic, whereas the Asari are very diplomatic.
Right.
And then the alien races, I looked into this a lot actually, it was incredibly interesting to me. They have very biological and scientific components to their design, like how the Asari are found attractive to every race, partially because it's speculated but never specified that they release like kind of like a neurochemical, like like a pheromone, yeah, that kind of activates. And what proves this to me, I think, is that the Solarians are a largely asexual race. Reproduction is a very long and arduous task for them because of the way their process takes place. So for the most part, they don't experience sexual attraction. But if you put a Solarian with an Asari, they will experience sexual attraction. And that's part of what I think kind of proves the pheromone theory. Is that they kind of like release that? I'm sorry, what?
The bachelor party.
Yeah,
that's
too.
Yeah. Like you listen to that whole conversation. They all talk about how the Asari look just like them. They all feel like the Asari look closer to their own race.
Yeah, the Asari have the head frills like the Turians. They have the colored skin like the Solarians, but they have the same bone structure as humans, and also almost Quarians too as well. So it's like they really look similar to a bunch of different races. Although I don't know what the Krogan. Thing is there.
It's the lifespan.
I guess. Yeah, because the Krogans have a really long lifespan. But it's like, this is going to be a huge part of this presentation. They all have, like, you can tell that BioWare worked really hard to give, like, biological components to these aliens' designs. Like, the Tyrians, that kind of carapace on the back of their neck right there is actually meant to shield them from radiation.
Oh.
It's the same with the Krogan, how they have very thick, like, tough scales and skin and stuff. T'Chanka is full of radiation after this nuclear war that they had, so they have to have that thick skin not only to protect them from their environments, but also from the radiation coming from pretty much everywhere. So you've got all these biological components. That's also why they're so muscular, is because there's so many things on their planet that could kill them.
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah, it's the Australia of the Milky Way. It really is. So
it's like all pressure
moths. Mother of all
pressure moths. Oh my god, that was such a fun fight though.
It was
frustrating,
but really, really fun. But so you've got all these different things that could kill them. So you've got to create this really hardy race in order to create a race that can thrive. Even through the genophage that they have, you've got to have all these components together in order to create a race that can actually be believable and survive in that type of environment. The same thing, like I was saying with the Asari, it encourages reproduction that they have that pheromone. That kind of like, and that's, there's, like you were saying, they, like, each of the races is just like, oh, you know, they're attracted to us because the head frills and stuff. It's like, it's either one or the other, or a combination of the both, that it's either their appearance or the pheromones or both of them. So I really find that interesting. I'm going to be honest, there's not a lot of other things I find interesting about the Asari, but
she's not a fan.
Yeah. Okay, I'm a fan of a few Asari. I like the new Andromeda chick, and I like Arya.
Two lines from
that.
And then when you're in ME3, when you go to Thessia, that, like, commander chick, she's badass.
Oh, yeah.
But the thing I don't like about the Asari is that they seem, personality-wise, very cut and paste. They're all these mysterious, motherly-type figures.
Well, the thing is,
except for Arya and this Andromeda chick, and then that commander, they're all, like, really bad. It's like, otherwise, they don't have a lot of, like, personality variants.
Well, BioWare straight up admitted at some point, I think, that they made the Asari to fill the skin colored, like, alien trope. Like,
the sexy blue ladies.
And they filled that trope. They admitted it.
But then the Solarians also another biological. They have very fast metabolisms. So that's why they think so fast. That's why a lot of them are, like, scientists and stuff, is because they're very intelligent. Their minds think and work very quickly. But that also comes with the side effect of their metabolisms are so fast, most Solarians don't live past 40. So Morden probably was actually kind of getting older by the time he died anyways, because I believe he was in his late 30s.
Yeah, he was talking about retirement
too. Yeah, so it's really sad. Oh, Morden. I miss him. Okay, Legion breaks my heart. I love the whole, like, that's another thing with the race. It's like they're not technically, like, they're an abiotic race. But the Geth, like, the collective conscience thing is so interesting to me, because it's like all of the Geth could theoretically learn from the experience of one unit. So it's really, really interesting to me, and you can tell that a lot of thought went into that.
For our Milky Way races.
I need to go back. This is the new video. Basically, it's about 5 minutes long. Let me see how much time we have. Oh my gosh. Oh wait, no. We started at 1:30. I thought we started at 1. I was like, we have 10 minutes.
2:30.
We end at 2:30. This is about 5 minutes long, but it's basically showing you just how, like, in-depth they go into the process for just designing the appearance of a new race, not necessarily the culture and stuff. This is just going into the appearance, and this is part of what makes these games so interesting, is that they go so in-depth. Just listening from this guy talking about this process, you can tell this probably took a few weeks to a couple of months to just design the appearance of a new race.
For our Milky Way races, they really are the cornerstone of Mass Effect. Mass Effect design that we know it, as the fans know it, as we know it, they will retain, you know, that sexy, sleek appeal that Mass Effect had. With the newer races, we wanted to approach them from a bit more of an organic perspective. So Mass Effect's clean, sleek, hard surfaces, well-designed industrial design, these newer races would have slightly more organic armor, more organic shape play, more organic materials that they would use to construct not only their armors, but also their structures and their architecture. It applies across anything you see in Andromeda. The start or the genesis of something like the Ket starts with their narrative. As I start walking through the concepts and the character, you'll start to see hints of what that narrative might be. We want to start with the phases, because that's what we need to draw the player in. We had a general theme in mind with these guys where we wanted to go with a bone carapace around his face that would hopefully translate into his armor as well. One of the things we tried to figure out with these guys being the antagonist is how alien are these guys, right? We're used to seeing, you know, our Milky Way species all kitted up in armor and essentially functioning like people would. Taking the opportunity to go out to Andromeda, do we want that same kind of relationship to our new aliens? We took a perspective of maybe these guys are so alien that we don't understand what they're doing visually. Like, do they even wear clothes? Are they more carnal than their previous aliens? Or are they more enlightened? Clothing's a vanity thing, and maybe that's not something that it was a part of their culture. In the initial sketches, we actually pushed that forward for quite a ways. So we definitely had to put clothing on these guys. We needed to dress them up, because as much as we wanted to make them look new or different or alien, you're always going to want to associate to them in some way. There's a really odd disconnect with trying to associate with an alien that is completely naked in front of you. You know, you stay there, hey, I'm in clothes, why aren't you wearing clothes? So it was definitely the right choice to clothe these guys. With the whole cat race, we wanted it to be foreboding, but never to the point of being ugly. And you still want to be able to empathize with these guys, because depending on how, we have a lot of side stories, we have a lot of stories we want to tell with this alien race. So despite how foreboding or scary they are, or antagonistic, you still want to be able to have opportunities to show them in an empathizing or an empathetic way. So yeah, again, playing up the eyes was really important on some of our main cat characters. And then obviously there's a certain militaristic element to these guys, so having some form of armor was important, and that's why we went with the bone armor. Felt new, it felt different, and it was something that we could play up with different types of variations. So as you can see in some of these spreads, like the white is meant to be representative of what that bone material would be. And so we found a lot of interesting opportunities within that design to use that material. For the grunt or the soldier, the most important part is that they read well in silhouette. And so what we would do is a lineup of these characters all placed one against another, and see which silhouettes really kind of read the best and felt characteristic to what the write-up would be. We do have limitations in terms of our rigs and what we can get away with. We share some rigs and that kind of thing. We want to pick a silhouette or a character that will function believably and properly on those rigs. So once that's done, we'll go in and start building out the additional designs and additional details within that silhouette. Usually the concept artist will give a spread of, you know, anywhere from 6 to 8 variations on that. We essentially chisel down the designs or the elements that we like the most until we get something that looks fairly representative of what we would like to see in-game. So we came across this guy. He was perfect. He had all the cool bone elements that we wanted. He had a nice kind of skin surfacing. He felt aggressive. At this point on this character, we decided that we wanted him to have a little bit less humanity or soul in him. So we pulled back on his eyes being the anchor for that. So we kind of washed them out or made them a little bit milky, and then started to work with game design on what we wanted or what they might want to incorporate in terms of any sort of destructible pieces or anything like that. We pass that across the team. We get a little bit of feedback from the team, and we figure out if there's any last minute notes or iterations that need to go into it. So one thing that we decided to do is to play up the tonal contrast between the bone and the skin itself. And so we did one more pass, and then following that is when we started to apply the armor onto these guys. And in doing that, it actually presented a really good opportunity for another kind of iconic element on this character, which we translated across that race. And he's got that big kind of collar piece that winds around the back of his head. All of the creatures that you might see in the cat have a very similar feature to that. It's something that we played on as a consistent motif or a consistent element across that lineup. But yeah, we ended up on this guy. It's nice. He feels covered. He feels functional. He feels like he fits the narrative and the tone of the game. And he animates really well on that rig. I think the cat is going to be one of the standout races in general. Their architecture, their race, their movement, everything. I think that's going to be an impressive addition to the franchise. It's definitely the one I'm the most proud of.
Yeah, I don't notice how many times he said it's like we like did a pass on it. Like they get that one character design, like that one race, racial design, probably passed through a couple of dozen people before they finally finalized it, because they had to make sure it was okay. Like they had to start it with the concept artist and start it with the writers, so the writers could talk about, you know, what kind of feel they wanted it to feel like, you know. And then they had to do the concept artist, and they had to put it through like the modelers and see what they could do with it, animation department to make sure it works with the rigs. They had to go through all kinds of people before they finally decided this is the type of character that we want. It's what fits the narrative, it's what animates well. So it's like they have to do so much work to just develop that one race, and it's just like, and that's just like the appearance of it. They haven't even gone into culture and personality traits and stuff like that. So it's just really interesting how much work they have to put into just the one thing. And then you think about it in terms of the entire game, where like they make several different races. It's like, it's just mind-boggling how much work they have to put into it, and it's just one of the things that kind of like, excuse me, makes the game so like stand out, is that there's so much detail. So then we're going to talk about the politics in the different games. That's another big part. There's a fly up here. It's a lot of what makes the games believable is that they kind of like incorporate the real world kind of politics. Is like the jostling for power, the people kind of thinking more of themselves more than, like, for example, in Dragon Age 2 with Viscount Dumar, he's really more interested in keeping a shallow peace than actually solving the city's problems. So it's more or less like, it makes it more convincing as far as like real world politics is concerned. It's more about jostling for power and kind of like keeping your own position rather than actually solving issues. The only one that ever actually tried to fix anything was Anderson, if you put him on the council. And even then, he's off the council by ME3 because it's just not his style.
I think it's also pretty interesting about how you get companions with different political views and beliefs. So even though you want to make everybody happy, it's kind of impossible.
Oh yeah, no, definitely.
No, not true Paragon.
Huh?
Not true Paragon.
Not true Paragon.
I make everybody happy.
Yeah. No, and then you've got like Morden, who absolutely opposes the genophage, but that's partially because his people developed the genophage. And then like he absolutely opposes the cure at first, and then realizes just how awful the genophage is, and is like, okay, I'm gonna cure this. But then you've got opposing views like in Dragon Age, especially in Inquisition, you cannot make everybody happy. And like DA2, I think, is one of the biggest examples of this as well, because if you have Anders and Fenris in your party, they are polar opposites completely. It's insane. You cannot make them both happy. You're going to piss one off while being friends with the other, or try to kind of go somewhere down the middle. But either way, you're not really gonna, unless you're like swapping them out and having them in your party at different times, you're not gonna be friends with both of them. Because they're just such polar opposites. Fenris, he doesn't hate mages, at least that's what he says, but he does not trust them at all. He thinks the circles and their oppression is an unnecessary need. Or an unnecessary need. An unfortunate necessity is what I meant to say. An unnecessary need. How about that oxymoron? oh, there's another service buffer in here. But yeah, it's like an unfortunate necessity. He doesn't like that the people have to go through what they do, but he thinks because of their connection to the Fade and because of their powers and abilities, it is a necessity. He does not trust mages in the least. Anders, on the other hand, thinks that mages should be free, even that he doesn't believe that all mages, you know, are going to use their ability to struggle for power, because, I mean, look at Anders. He lives in the slums and he just heals people all the time. So it's like, he thoroughly believes that mages can coexist peacefully with people, bless you, without any kind of conflict, which honestly, if you think about it, really isn't the case. I like, at the end of Inquisition, if you've got Liliana as your...
divine.
As your divine, yeah. She doesn't reestablish the circles. She creates colleges, like mage colleges, for the mages to go and study at. And honestly, there's really not a whole lot of conflict. After the initial, you know, the non-mages kind of being like, hey, what the heck are you doing, you know, just a little bit of like conflict and uprising there and stuff, like after that initial bit, it becomes pretty peaceful. So she kind of understands, she's just like, yeah, the mages need to know how to control their abilities, they need to be at least somehow kept in check, but they shouldn't be treated the way they were before. Mm-hmm. So it's kind of like that.
Plus you don't mess with Liliana.
You don't mess with Liliana. But yeah, you've got that kind of going on. So you've got the nobility and bureaucracy as well, the fall of King Kaelin. Poor King Kaelin. He was kind of a dingus, honestly, but like he was great. He was great. He was an awesome dingus. Power struggle in Orzammar, where you've got the Adukins and the... What's the other one?
The
Haramonts, yeah. Nobody cares about Haramont. The thing with that, that's another interesting dichotomy there, is that you either get the Adukin, who's a complete and total a-hole. Okay, he's this really cruel person, but the thing is, he's also the one who, he's got a very horrible, like, ethical and moral code, but an excellent mind for politics. Like, under Adukin, Orzammar thrives. If you pick Haramont because, hey, he's a nicer guy, he's gonna be gentler, he's so lax on everything, and also very anti-outsider, that, excuse me, even if you pick Haramont, He's usually dethroned by the second or third game because there's so much turmoil and uprising under his rule, and nothing happens. Like, so you have this choice between this really nice guy who's, you know, probably telling the truth when he said that the previous king asked him to become the next king, or you side with the guy that's actually going to help his society even while being a total turd about it. So it's just kind of like an interesting dichotomy there. It makes you make these really tough choices, basically. So you've also obviously got the military themes present in Mass Effect. You've got the Alliance. You've got Turians have a very strong military. Mm-hmm. The Krogan are very militaristic. One thing I forgot to mention on the religion slide also earlier about the Krogan is they're very, like, shamanic religion. They have the shamans for all the clans and stuff, and that's kind of how... So that's also very interesting. I kind of saw the... I was really for the Genophage Cure because I saw their entire culture outside of their, you know, war... Their bloodlust and militarism. Their entire culture outside of that is really interesting, and as long as you put the ladies in charge, they're going to be fine. It's the men that are just like, testosterone!
Yeah.
And the ladies are just like, you're all idiots. But... Because y'all remember the female Krogan. You remember the female.
Eva was awesome.
Eve was great.
Yeah, the female Krogan in the third game, she's just like, she's basically like, anytime Rex wanted to fight you, she's like, Rex, shut up. So it's just like, as long as you let the ladies at least advise on certain things, the men probably won't go out and get themselves killed. So it's just a really interesting culture, honestly. Yeah, so then you've got the morality. I've got a whole bunch of examples of it on here. This is not comprehensive in the least, but you've got a whole bunch of moral dichotomies. Paragon Renegade system in Mass Effect. You've got the diplomatic, sarcastic, and aggressive memes in Dragon Age. I think that was especially true with Hawk.
Yes.
But that happens again also in Inquisition, but mainly Hawk. To a lesser extent.
And it's
in
really hard to figure out what's what sometimes in those dialogues.
Yeah, at least with Hawk, it straight up told you.
Aspect.
Yeah.
It tells you.
Yeah, it, like, it straight up tells you. My first Shepherd is like the sassy little thing. I love her. But, like, but yeah, you've got these moral dichotomies like across each series. It's kind of like not only moral, but psychological themes. Logan genuinely thinks he's doing the right thing for Ferelden by betraying the Grey Wardens and King Caden, because he thinks that allying with Orlais is the worst possible thing for Ferelden after they just got out of a war with them.
Frick Orlais.
Orlesian culture is so interesting, but it's like, they're all so pompous.
Watch your profanity!
Better wash these hands.
That's good. And then you've got Saren. That one's really interesting because not only was he, I can't remember the word because I haven't played anyone in so long.
Really a puppet.
But like under the Reaper's influence.
Indoctrinated.
Indoctrinated. Not only was he indoctrinated, but he was thoroughly convinced that by submitting to the Reapers, he's saving everyone. He's like, the only way we can survive is to do what they tell us. So it's like, that's really interesting because he's, at first he's made out to be this villain. It's like, why do you want to kill everybody? Why are you siding with them? And he's like, I'm not killing you. I am saving you. And even though he's completely wrong, you still kind of have that side. And then there's Matt Commander Meredith, who's completely driven mad by the Red Lyrium and thinks that destroying all the mages will save the city. When in reality, there's a fly up here.
Yeah.
When in reality, she's kind of doing the opposite in that she's pushing the mages over the edge and causing basically the beginning of this massive worldwide uprising, or at least throughout Southern Thetis uprising, because the mages obviously in Tevinter already have all these rights. You've got Anders, who blows up a church.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. He throws up.
So he's Guy Fawkes?
He blows up the chantry. He blows up the entire freaking chantry because he's just like, we can't compromise anymore. There is no compromise at this point. It's like, we fight or we die. So he kind of like, he thinks, again, it's like, what he did was awful, but he thinks he did it for the right reason, even though it basically almost made things worse for mages across Thetis, because then there's the mages, I don't know if any of y'all have seen the movie with Cassandra, Rise of the Seekers. You've got,
oh no, I forgot his name.
Galleon. I love Galleon.
How dare you?
No.
Shut
my husband, how dare you?
Okay. But yeah, and then you've got Galleon, who fully supports the circle because that's a safe place for him to practice his art. And honestly, the circle he's in is not so bad. You've got this huge dichotomy between circles and Orlais. Like, I also read, you haven't given it back to me yet. I lent it to you.
Oh, yeah.
Mm-hmm. Asunder, where you kind of like get Cole's backstory. Cole is my child, okay? I love Cole. He's my favorite character in the entire series. But in Asunder, it's like you've got the White Spire, which really is not nearly as bad as Ferelden, but not as good as, say, the Montsemar Circle, where Vivienne is from, where she was kind of like in charge there. She gave the mages enough freedom to practice their art, but not enough freedom to rebel. So you've got this huge dichotomy between circles, and even in Montsemar, even if you talk to Vivienne and ask her about the Montsemar Circle, she's just like, yeah, every other circle in Thedas knew that Kirkwall was awful. So, like, you just kind of, you know, you've got all these dichotomies going on and stuff. So Andrew's kind of like, basically, by blowing up the Chantry and Kirkwall, made things really awful for other circles. Because after Andrew's blew up the Chantry, Fiona basically voted for all of those circles to rebel, and they almost uniformly had to listen to her or submit themselves to the Templars.
And if you go a bit more into it, it actually explains that like most of the mages didn't want to rebel, but because she chose to, they had to either follow or go against her.
Yeah. So, and then you've got Jacob Taylor, again, not a super severe dichotomy, but he's somebody who wants to do the right thing, and the only way, he's a lot like Shepard, in that the only way he can do it is by joining Cerberus. He hates Cerberus. He does not trust Cerberus in the least, but in order to fight the Reapers, he has to work with them. So it's not as huge a moral dichotomy. It's kind of like, if you're playing Shepard a certain way in that game, it's like, you don't trust Cerberus, you fully believe that you are using them and not the other way around. Mm-hmm. Then you've got Calpurnia, again, she's trying to basically make things better for the slaves in Taventure. She's trying to free the slaves in Taventure. She thinks if she joins Corypheus, then he'll help her do that. She has no idea that she's being used. You can actually convince her and basically reveal to her, it's like, he's not going to do what you want. And then she's like,
I love Calpurnia so much. She's one of my favorite characters in that series.
I think the biggest one also is going to be Solas. A lot of people really hate Solas. I love to hate Solas.
I mean, she made the mistake of romancing him her first playthrough of that game.
Okay, so you got this guy. He's basically a god, for one thing. And you don't know that. There's so many hints dropped throughout the game where after he reveals that to you that he is Fenhadel, you look back and you're like, I should have caught that.
Wait,
what? Yeah. Yeah, no. I should have caught that. It's like, yeah, basically. Yeah, you look back and you're like,
I know.
But
wait, did you
even
play
I don't have the system. I'm going to now that I can play it on my computer. But yeah, and then we've got, yeah, so basically he's like, he wants to destroy everyone but the elves and then restore his race to its former glory because he feels personally responsible for what happened to them. If you don't know the history behind that, basically what happened is you've got these Evanudis, which are these ancient elves that are given these special powers. They're not actually gods, but the Dalish now, because they have very little of their ancestral past, worship them as such. And so it actually turns out that they're all a-holes, except Mithal and Fenharel. They're all kind of like selfish, power-mongering a-holes. So they all turn against Mithal and kill her because she freed the slaves, and they're like, that's not cool. So they turn against Mithal and killed her. So Fenharel, being the god of trickery and also rebellion, tricks them into basically trapping themselves. He tricks them into basically going into the Fade, and then he creates the veil that separates the Fade from the real world, but that also robs the elves of their immortality and their magic. So he feels personally responsible for the fall of his race, so he's going to tear down the veil to bring them back to power. And it's like, you know, he thinks he's doing right by his people, but he's actually destroying everything. And he's actually really conflicted about it, because after he kind of like becomes friends and like really joins the Inquisition and really gets into it, he's like, I feel like I have to do this, but I don't want to, but he thinks he has to. So there's a big moral dichotomy there. We've spent a lot of time on the side. So
he puts himself into a corner.
Yeah, he kind of does. I'm hoping we have time at the end of the panel to kind of discuss. We've got like 20 minutes. but I'm hoping we've got time at the end. And luckily, there's not another panel after this, so like we don't have to break down early or anything. But I'm hoping we have time at the end to kind of discuss things about like maybe speculation for the new games, especially. But then you've got, you know, the prevalent theme of discrimination in both series, especially a lot of people, and I, this is another one I didn't really touch on earlier with the Koreans and race and stuff. They're very much like the Romani Jews in Europe. Like they're basically, they don't really have much of a homeland, so they're like these wandering people, and a lot of places kind of like discriminate against them. They won't let them stay within city limits. I remember reading a story about a little Romani girl that died, and the town that she died in would not let her family bury her there because she was Romani. So it's very much like that, where they're kind of seen as these wandering migrants, and so they're seen as thieves that just like show up, steal your stuff, and then run away. So it's very much like that. If you remember, there's actually a small little side quest in the Citadel in Mass Effect 2 about it, where this Volus thinks that Corian, he forgot his credit chip at a store and immediately assumes that a Corian stole it. And then when you find his chip and give it back to him, he's just like, well, she could have stolen it. It's like, that's not how you apologize.
No.
It's like, so you've kind of got that going on. And then obviously the Krogan with the Genophage, they're seen as just these warmongering beasts that need to be controlled. And so they're basically, and that's kind of like the most extreme example of it, I think, because they're literally like almost given a death sentence for their entire race just because of the way they are. So discrimination is a huge theme, especially, and then when you get into Dragon Age, every non-human race in Thedas is basically discriminated against. Less so the dwarves, because, you know, the merchants and stuff, it's like, hey, if we discriminate against them, we're not going to get money. So, less so the dwarves, more so especially elves and Quinari, because they look so different. I thought I said hand blow up, sorry. They look so different, and then the elves are literally enslaved into winter. So you've got that. You've got a lot of it, like I was saying, with the Romani. It reflects real-world cultural groups with the Romani Jews and stuff. And you've even got discrimination within the human race against other humans, and Varric even comments on it, and he's just like, humans can't do anything without basically blowing something up. But it's like, you've got discrimination against, like, if you're in the free marches, and, you know, you meet somebody from Ferelden, they're just kind of, like, viewing you as lesser than them because you're a refugee and a dog lord, and it's just like... But then you've got, if you go to Orlais, if you're, because pretty much any character that you choose in Inquisition is based in the Free Marches somehow. So if you're a human and you go to Orlais for the Wicked Eyes, Wicked Hearts, they're just going to be like, ugh, the Inquisitor's a Free Marcher? It's like, really? It's like, I can't make you happy, can I?
You can't win in that, but you have
to work for it. But a lot of it really reflects the real world cultural groups and problems. So, yeah, and then you've got the diversity, which I think is a huge part. You've got a huge part in making the games more immersive, because like I said earlier, you've got, like, not every single character in the game is like a white dude. So, you've got different races, more Cerberus, more like Cerberus. Cerberus is the entire reason I always go with Templars. I go with the Templars because I hate the Mage Quest.
The Templar game was so much harder.
I hated it. The Templars is fun because you get coal.
Yeah.
This is true.
You get coal, and he talks to you and helps you through your problems, and that's exactly what he's there for. And he's a baby. You just love coal.
I love coal.
I have keychains and stickers, and I have a tote bag with his face on it. I love coal. But you've got a lot of, you've got a lot of racial, cultural, ethnic, and sexual diversity. You've got all kinds of different sexualities. Again, even within the human race, you've got different skin tones and stuff. There's actually a lot of issue in as far as the fandom goes, where David Guider, who's not the lead writer anymore, but would design these characters with darker skin, and then when they got put in the game, their skin was lightened up. So that was a big issue, especially with Isabella and Fenris. They were, also Alistair, a lot of people don't know this, Alistair is biracial. He is the son of the king, but his mother was Fiona. And Fiona was supposed to be very dark-skinned, but was made extremely light-skinned in the game. Alistair is supposed to be biracial. Half elbow. we had a discussion about that. But yeah, Alice, you've got a lot of racial diversity, but there is also a bit of like an issue about that as far as like the publisher and the people doing the animation kind of like whitewashing some of the characters. Isabella mm-hmm. is a lot lighter skinned than she was supposed to be. They seem to fix a lot of it in Inquisition. Like, you've got Varys, who's very dark skinned, so you've kind of got that going at least, but it's like it doesn't really make up for what they did in the earlier games as far as the whitewashing goes. So you've got like these characters that are supposed to be dark-skinned, and then they're just kind of light. A lot of people are mad about that.
Another thing about Inquisition kind of expanding it better is that rather than people thinking diversity as like, we've got white people and we've got black people, and that's our diversity. We've got, say, Dorian, where Tevinter is supposed to be heavily influenced by like Italian and like those kind of dark-skinned nations.
And you've got Josephine.
Very heavily coded as being Spanish, which I
personally
love.
She's very, very, very Spanish and stuff. You've got like the different, like Isabella's supposed to be Ravani, which is supposed to be a lot like, what did they say? Was it Italy?
Italy, Portugal,
stuff like that. You've got Josephine and Zevran. You've got different countries and cultures and stuff. So they kind of tried to make up for the whitewashing and Inquisition. You've got snippets of language even kind of mixed in there. You've got the Elvish. A lot of the languages are dead, which is kind of like upsetting. But it also does explain why there's only a few words in each language. You've got the Elvish, the Dwarvish, like the Dwarven language. They've only got a little bit. But the Kunari, they still speak Kunari. I love that Fenris knows how to speak the Kunari tongue. It's because it's just like, it was useful to his master, so he had to learn it. But it's just, it kind of ends up being useful to you too, and kind of like bartering with the Aerith shop. Screw that guy. We don't like the Aerith shop. But like I said, you've also got the variation within the races as well that makes it even more immersive. But you've got the surface dwarves versus Orzammar, which is another actually point of contention with the discrimination that we touched on earlier, where the surface dwarves are seen as lesser because they don't belong in Orzammar. They're either exiled or they chose to left and so are now exiled, so they can't go back.
Yeah, that's more of a class thing.
You've got the caste system in Orzammar as well, or the caste, however you pronounce it. Yeah, basically. Dalish versus City Elves. You've got the City Elves. In the first game, the City Elves don't even know the Dalish exist. They're kind of like a myth at first. They thought it was a myth, yeah. And so then they kind of finally learn about each other. But the Dalish look down upon the City Elves. They see them as like flat ears, like trying to be human and stuff. It's like, you don't know what they go through. Different human races, we already kind of touched on that. The Kunari under the Kune versus the Talvashoth, the Vashoth. You know, except the Asari. Again, not a whole lot of variation there. I'm still mad. They could have done better, I think, as far as like they just a few more characters similar to Arya or that Asari commando chick.
They had the matriarch.
That's all they had to do. Well, the matriarch Venezia, but she still had that same kind of feel about her, where she was just this mysterious, motherly, feminine figure.
Well,
and it's like
matriarch.
Oh yeah. And then you've got sexuality. Promiscuous is a classy. He's a classy guy. So you've got a lot of groundbreaking. They kind of like started off really slow with it, kind of like testing the waters to see how well it would be received. And then when it was actually really well received, they went nuts. But yeah, they kind of started with Liara as their first kind of bisexual character, kind of attributed to the Asari upbringing. It's a monogendered race, so they can basically reproduce and fall in love with any sex from any race.
Nice.
That's another kind of interesting thing about the Asari that allows them to reproduce and be basically very prolific. But you've got all kinds of representation with bisexuals, homosexuals. I think I would say probably Mass Effect 2 would be the first game where you've got exclusively homosexual characters as opposed to Inquisition. But you've got characters of different sexualities, which makes it really interesting because they're not all like in Dragon Age 2, they were all bisexual. It's like either or, unless you got a DLC character, Sebastian. No homo there. But that make that made me sad because I did a playthrough as Mihawk when I got that DLC and I wanted the romance.
Sebastian was kind of a weird romance anyway because you couldn't really like do much with him regardless.
Yeah,
he's a chantry boy.
But yeah, you've got basically I just found it really especially immersive that you've got those exclusively homosexual characters. Like you can't date Sarah if you're a man. You can't date Dorian if you're a woman, although you can still do the flirty banter, which is so much fun with him. Okay?
It's fun. I was so sad.
Adorable.
I didn't know.
Adorable is like my thing. Wait, you can actually get Dorian and Iron Bull to hook up if you have them in your party moment.
It takes so much work.
It takes a lot of time, but it's.
I do it every time.
Because
Iron Bull, it's like I should be, y'all should be right.
He will sleep with anything, okay? He will. It's pretty great. I love how Colin's like a 5-year-old, like a 12-year-old boy about it too. Like, so I take it actually he's the one who's been taking it, and Colin just. Colin that is a 12-year-old boy.
That scene is what got me into the entire series. I saw it on YouTube, and I was like, I need to play these games now.
Done.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. No, it's pretty great. But yeah, you've got the exclusively, it just makes it more convincing because like, at least, you know, in Dragon Age 2, it was refreshing that you could basically date the characters regardless of gender, but not everyone in the real world is like that.
Right.
There are people that are exclusively straight, there are people that are bisexual, there are people that are asexual. It's widely speculated that Josephine is asexual because there are absolutely no sex scenes whatsoever, not even anything that implies it in her romance. In Inquisition, it's widely speculated that she's asexual because of that. Then you've got, like, it just basically makes it more immersive because it's like, not everybody is bi, not everybody's straight. You've got the homo-only characters like Sarah, and then you've got pansexual characters like Bull that literally just don't care. So it's like, it's just really interesting, and as I touched on earlier, the Solarians are kind of represented as asexual, but that's partially because of the biological component that reproduction is so difficult for them, poor things. And then you've got your first openly transgender character in Promiscius the Classy. Krem was great. There's just one thing that I think a lot of people kind of talk about with Krem being trans, and that a lot of the dialogue about it, when you talk to him about it, is really cringy. There are questions that you don't actually ask a trans person, and if you do, it's considered highly offensive. A lot of the point of Krem, not just Krem, but also like Dorian in a different way, was to educate the audience on that type of demographic.
You can't really figure out, like, you don't get to talk to Krem about it unless you ask the cringy questions.
But, yeah. There, you gotta make out with these mics if you want to be heard. But yeah, Krem is like, a lot of the questions you ask him are very cringy. You don't want to ask an actual trans person because they're very offensive. But a lot of the point of that character was to kind of like educate you on the transgender characters. I feel like they actually did that as a way to open the door to other less cringy dialogue trans characters later. Like maybe Mavaris.
Oh, yes.
If
she is not in the next game, I'm going to be so mad.
She's a transgender magister from Tevinter who is actually Varric's cousin by marriage. So it's really interesting how it all works out that way. But yeah, you've got that trans. And then this, I think this next one is the last slide. It's just kind of like a scene about how Dorian was very much a character made to kind of like, I don't want to say preach, that makes it sound kind of like rude almost, but it's like Dorian was another character that's very much meant to open the audience's eyes to how gay people are treated in the real world. So a lot of this actually kind of alludes to conversion therapy, which is a highly controversial topic, but this next scene kind of like, again, it's meant to be an eye opener to people that maybe don't have experience with it. So the loading thing in the corner. This is the one with his father, yes, in the tavern in Redcliff. Yeah, I almost said Redcliff.
Uh-oh, nobody's here. This doesn't bode well. Dorian. Father. And the whole story about the family retainer was just, what, a smokescreen? Then you were told. I apologize for the deception, Inquisitor. I never intended for you to be involved. Of course not. Magister Parvus couldn't come to Skyhold and be seen with the Dread Inquisitor. What would people think? What is this exactly, Father? ambush, kidnapping, warm family reunion. This is how it has always been.
You went through all of this to get Dorian here. Talk to him.
Yes, Father. Talk to me. Let me hear how mystified you are by my anger. Dorian, there's no need to. I prefer the company of men. My father disapproves.
This Inquisitor takes a long time to make their choices.
That's a big concern, Tevinterven.
Only if you're trying to live up to an impossible standard. Every Tevinter family is intermarrying to distill the perfect mage, perfect body, perfect mind, the perfect leader. It means every perceived flaw, every aberration is deviant and shameful. It must be ill.
I'm sorry.
So that's what all of this is about. Who you sleep with.
That's not all it's about. Dorian, please. If you'll only listen to me. Why? So you can spout more convenient lies? He taught me to hate blood magic. The resort of the weak mind. Those are his words. But what was the first thing you did when your precious heir refused to play pretend for the rest of his life? You tried to change me.
I basically stopped it there because he drops an F-bomb right afterwards, and I figured this panel needs to be mostly family friendly, but I believe that's the end of the slideshow. So basically, just kind of like wrapping it up, the reason these games are so interesting is that they're so realistic, that there's so much work put into every aspect of them to make it detailed and convincing, that it makes it so much more like convincing and immersive for the audiences. So I think we have like 5 minutes. Toss. I guess we don't. Did anybody have any questions? I guess.
Yes. What are you looking forward to most with Andromeda coming
with
up?
With Andromeda?
Yeah.
Oh, that's a really great question. I like the aspect that the writers are going to be siblings.
Yeah.
That's really interesting to me. So it's like you don't have one writer or the other. You're going to play as one, but the other one is still going to be there, and that's just super exciting to me. I'm not entirely sure why.
Also, those graphics.
Those graphics look amazing, yes. But remember, the cinematic trailers always look good. But then again, they did have a clip of gameplay in there, so that looks really good. I wanted to throw out... I just realized, like, while I was playing Inquisition, this is something I wanted to throw out there for y'all to maybe steep on, is, like, if you think about what Solus wants to achieve, and then think about everything that Meryl does in Dragon Age 2, evolving the OU beyond, I'm really well convinced that Meryl and Fenris are probably going to make some kind of cameo in the next Dragon Age game, because who would be more pissed off about some, you know, big-headed elven god trying to force magic on every elf in the world than Fenris? And then you've got Meryl, who basically was trying to do the same thing that Solus is doing and bring back the ancient elven culture, to bring back the power of her people, to bring back that knowledge, and that's exactly what Solus is doing. So I would not at all be surprised if we get either Meryl fighting on Solus' side or fighting against Solus, because she's like, this is what I want, but this is not the way I want to do it. So I would not at all be surprised. And then if you've seen the most recent trailer, I feel like I should have thrown it in there. At the very end of Trespasser, they put a dagger in the middle of Tevinter, like that's where they're going. So yeah. I think we're finally going to get to see Tevinter, so I would not at all, like we mentioned earlier, Mavaris, I would not at all be surprised if we saw Mavaris in there. Dorian probably as well, because he goes back to Tevinter at the end of Trespasser.
Yep.
Dorian, maybe Bull. Freddie Prinze Jr., the voice actor for Iron Bull, does a lot of work with BioWare, really? So he'd probably be more than thrilled to come back for another Dragon Age game.
Is there any more DLCs from Dragon Age Inquisition?
There are three proper DLCs. There's Trespasser. Trespasser was supposed to be the last one.
Which is kind of an extension. It's more of an extension. You have to have Trespasser to fully end the game.
To get the story.
But then you've got Jasmine Khan and...
The one in... Yeah. What's it called again?
You've got Jaws of Hakon, and I think it's like Dissension or something.
Descent.
I don't know. I haven't played them. I tried to download Jaws of Hakon, and my poor little PS3 could not handle it. It doesn't work at all anymore. I even uninstalled it, and my PS3 just doesn't work at all anymore.
Aww. That's a sad day.
It was backwards compatible, too.
No!
I'm so sorry.
You deserve a hug for that. Oh, that sucks.
My brother's good at fixing stuff. Maybe the next time he comes home, he can look at it. Yeah, we are right at 2:30. There's no other panels or anything after this, but if y'all want to go or if y'all want to hang around afterwards and ask any more questions, thanks for coming, y'all.
Thank you for having
me. Yeah, I hope y'all enjoyed it. This was the first time I've ever run this panel, so.
Awesome. Oh.